Father, we just give you praise. We give you all the thanks, Lord, because you're such an amazing God. And we just want to tell you how much we love you and how much we really, really want you to speak to us. My God, we're living in an hour of church history when we really need to hear the voice of God. And Lord, I honestly just ask you today, Holy Spirit, move in a mighty way in Jesus' name. You know, in the beginning of time, God spoke and he declared the things of God. And God spoke to Abraham. He spoke to all the patriarchs and different people. But then about 2,000 plus years ago, there was a man by the name of Jesus that came on this planet. And it appears as if then God handed over the reins to Jesus. And Jesus came and he spoke amongst the people and he demonstrated the power of God. He demonstrated the anointing. I really believe that he revealed to the world again what God was really like. That he's a God of love and a God of mercy. And he did amazing things. He forgave, he healed, he delivered, he gathered, he empowered. He did it so much. And then Jesus said amazing words. He said, it's better for you if I go. Because if I go, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you. And friends, today we really need the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit power again to come and quicken our minds and encourage us. And I believe as a people, we need to have an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying. Because there are a lot of voices going on today. There are a lot of good ideas that are going on today. There's a lot of theories and different things on how to do this and how to do that. But all I know is this, that God said, unless the Lord builds the house, they that build it labor in vain. And so I believe that today we're living in a time of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And I really delight in speaking a lot about the Holy Spirit. I'm going to continue from last week. Last week, if you remember, I just spoke a few things over a couple of them very quickly. Dwelling inside you right now is a built-in, God-created substance called faith. Every one of us have the measure of faith. Every one of us have that. And all you need to achieve God's purpose in your life is in you right now. And I think one of the great troubles with life is that we're always searching and never finding, because the thing that we're looking for is already on the inside of us. It's already there. And I want to encourage you today to dare to believe what God says you can do. Dare to believe what God says you can have. And if God speaks it, he doesn't lie. The Bible says God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Has he not said it, or has he not spoken it, will he not also bring it to pass? So this day that we're living in, I want to really encourage you today, because we're living in a time when there are many voices, there are many things that are happening, but somehow or other we've got to stir ourselves up again to faith to believe God. So dare to believe what God says you can have and do. I'd like for you to open up your Bibles to the book of Luke chapter 1. And just, I want to speak a little bit about the miraculous, a little bit about God moving by his Spirit. When God does things, how sometimes it's all impossible in the natural, but God somehow brings it to pass. And it says here in verse 13, it says, but the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you shall call his name John. I think God is very, very specific here. He says, you're going to call his name John. And I think he knew that that would cause a little bit of a problem, because that isn't what was normally done. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He shall also be filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. What an amazing thing. Here is a man that's of an old age, but the Spirit of God speaks to him. An angel speaks to him and tells him things that he just thinks, man, that is impossible. And even as he heard these words in his mind and in his emotions, he said, that is impossible. You know, we've wanted this for a long time. Can I say this, friend? We can hear a lot of things with our head. But it's time, I believe, that we need to sort of put our head aside and allow us to hear something from the inside. We need to have this inner something, this inner voice, this speaking to the inner man so that we can rise up. Because many times the natural things are foolishness to those of the Spirit. And so we're not just to hear with our natural, but we're to hear with the supernatural. And it's an amazing thing. What an amazing God we serve. I want to just read some more scriptures here from verse 30. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." Again, call his name Jesus. "And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also, that the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren." I'm glad he said that. "For with God, nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. And Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste to the city of Judah, and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. And it happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she spoke with a loud voice, "Blessed are you among women." Here is a story. Mary, just an amazing thing. Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit and immediately begins to prophesy. Here's a situation that seems so, so impossible. So very, very impossible. We need to really hear this. It doesn't matter how impossible it sounds to your natural. I believe that the Spirit of God wants to overshadow us. I believe the Spirit of God wants to come and visit with His church. We can't put Him in a corner. We can't separate Him. Friend, without God, I believe to ignore the Holy Spirit is to ignore what God wants to do on planet Earth. I believe that we need to hear again what God says. You got to look at this situation. There's a virgin and a barren woman. They might have called her barren, but the moment that she conceived, change takes place. Friend, your life may be in a mess. It may be where you don't know where you're going. It may be that you don't know what's really going on, and there's confusion, and there's like a war that rages within us. I would imagine Zacharias, as he was there, and he would have been longing for a son, but now all of a sudden an angel appears to him. Fear came upon him, but the angel starts to speak to him and starts to share what seems to be impossible. This woman that was barren, they called her barren. How would you like that if people started calling you barren, barren, barren? Why? Because there's no fruit. There's nothing really happening. People might look at the church today and they might call it barren. They might say there's not much happening. But I want to tell you, the moment that the Holy Spirit can put something on the inside of us and we conceive something, I want to tell you, we'll no longer be barren, amen. But we'll produce what God wants us to produce. But this, it's got to be a work of the Spirit. We've got to come again. We've got to bow our knee again. We've got to say, "God, break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything for the kingdom cause. God, do a work in my life." There's got to come a cry again from the people of God. Friend, I want to say we are not just churchgoers. Friend, if we're just going to go to church, if we're just going to come to church, we might as well quit now. You can do this at home. You can sit in front of Jimmy Swaggart. You can sit in front of some of the greatest teachers in the world. Don't just come to church, but somehow or other let the Spirit of God get inside of us. Let Him plant a seed in the barrenness of your life. Don't quit. Don't say it's over. Don't say it's hopeless. Don't say things, friends. Whatever you say, start to say what God says. Amen. He says, in the last days, I'm going to pour out of my Spirit. I'm going to raise up my church. I'm going to build my church that the gates of Hades will not prevail against. I don't care what I see. I'm going to speak what the Word of God says. I'm going to share what the Spirit of God is saying in this hour, because I believe that God is raising up His church. I believe that it's got to be a move of the Spirit. But I wanted just to speak those about those impossible situations. A virgin girl and a barren woman. But the moment that she conceived, she was no longer barren. The moment that you can conceive something in your spirit on the inside of you, you will no longer be barren. You will no longer just be somebody in the naughty corner over in the west or over the bush or wherever it might be. But you will be somebody that will be effective in the kingdom of God. Amen. Because I believe that God wants to raise us up. Let God raise you up today. Let God move by His Spirit. In Matthew chapter 3, let's have a quick look in Matthew chapter 3. Amazing things happened in Matthew chapter 3, verse 11. I indeed baptize with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you in the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit and with fire. See, I don't know and I can't understand how we can remove the Holy Spirit from the modern day church. I do not know how we can remove Him and put Him somewhere out there and say that those things are finished, it's over, we don't want to talk in tongues, we don't want to do this, we don't want to do that. Friend, I want to tell you, it's time to put aside some of the rubbish that we've heard, and we've got to invite the Holy Spirit again to invade our lives, that He would put something on the inside of us, because the Holy Spirit, God wants to come into your life in power and authority. Jesus came, He said, I baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me, John the Baptist said, who is mightier than I. And when he comes, he's going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit and with fire. Amen. If ever we need the fire of God, we need the fire of God. We're having a look at a government that's going crazy. We're looking at things that are happening all over the world where people are being run down by trucks. We're looking at the youth that are gone crazy on drugs and goodness knows what else. We're looking at things that are happening. Friend, I want to tell you, there's only one thing that can arrest that. It's a move of the Spirit. It's the church that's got to rise up. I went there and I was talking to the leaders of whatever they were, the state parliament people that were going to be elected or wanting to be elected. And I stood up there and I said, you've got to understand that this war is not a natural war. It is a spiritual war. And the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. I want to tell you, all your good ideas are not really going to help. But what you need is the Holy Spirit. You need a move of the Spirit, because it's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Friend, we cannot separate the Holy Ghost from the church today. I long for the Holy Ghost to invade. I long for Him to shake this place until everything that can be shaken is shaken. And I pray that every bit of dross and every bit of rubbish that's on the inside of me will be pushed out in Jesus' name, and I can be wholly His. We need a move of the Spirit. We need a move of the Spirit that will captivate and challenge and do amazing things, amazing things. It says in verse 19, he said, now this is the testimony of John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites to Jerusalem to ask him, who are you? He confessed and did not deny, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Are you Elijah? He said, I am not. Are you a prophet? He answers, no. And he said to them, who are you? That we may give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? And he said these words, I am. I love that. Amen. I am. I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. I want to say, friends, I believe that God wants to do some things in our lives that will change us forever and ever and ever. That in the verse 29, it says, "And the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Oh, man. "This is he whom I said, 'After me comes a man who is preferred before me, for he was before me.'" Here is a story of John as he's there going to baptize Jesus. He says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." Now we'll go to Luke. Luke chapter 3. "When all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also was baptized. And while he prayed, the heavens was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, 'You are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased.'" Jesus himself began his ministry at about 30 years of age. Here is a situation. Jesus had to be filled with the Holy Spirit, just like you and I. And Jesus comes now to a point in his life where he begins his ministry. And he goes, as a good Jewish boy would, to the synagogue. This is how he used to live. This is how he lived. And these people would have known him. These people would have said, "Hey, this is Jesus. Come on in, Jesus." And they would have said, "Would you like to do the reading today?" And he said, "Yeah, that'll be fine." And as he stood there and he said these words, he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God has anointed me." God has anointed me. What an amazing statement. But really, what he was saying is, I was 30 years of age and I was walking down towards the river. Friend, we need to start walking down towards the river. You need to start walking down where the Spirit of God's moving. You know, we need to start getting under the spout where the glory comes out. We need to go looking for where God is, where the Spirit of God is. And he said, "I was walking down towards the river, and there was a man baptizing people. And he called out to me," he said, "'Hey, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.' And I walked down towards him and I said, 'John, baptize me.' He said, 'Oh no, I don't need to baptize. You baptize.' He said, 'Baptize me.' And I went under the water, and as I came out of the water, the Spirit of God came upon me. The Holy Spirit came upon me." Friend, he was testifying about something that was more just a little word. No, he said, "The Spirit of the Lord fell upon me." Church, we need the Spirit of God again to fall upon us. Amen. We need to get hungry for the things of God. We need to hunger again and thirst for righteousness. We need to cry out to God, "God, pour out your Spirit again." Friend, I want to tell you, there's something that happens when you start to stir, when you start to build something of yourself in the spirit realm, that God will come. There was a woman who had had an issue of blood for 12 odd years. She'd spent everything that she had and was growing worse. But there came a thing in her life where she said something that caused a change in her life. Friend, she could have stayed that way forever. She could have died in that state. Friend, I want to say this. We can die in a state of negativity. We can die in a state of defeat and failure. But I want to tell you, there's something that will change your whole destiny. There's something that will change your whole purpose is when you start going after that which is of God. It is not a time to play church. It is not a time to act out something. It is a time to allow the Spirit of God to have His way in our life. And that comes out of a hunger. And this woman made a statement that was such a powerful statement. And she said, if I can but touch the hem of His garment, I will be made whole. And so what she did was she started to move towards what she was looking for. Friend, can I say this? If you want to move of the Holy Ghost, don't just sit around playing lullabies. It won't work. We've got to go after it. You've got to start building yourself up, speaking in tongues, speak in tongues, speak in tongues, hallelujah. Sing in the natural, sing in the spirit, but allow, build that up inside you. Oh, and Friday, I think it was. Friday, and by the way, anybody that wants to come to our, we pray every morning up there from 9 till 9:30 at the Hub. You're more than welcome to come. But last Friday there, we prayed for a half an hour, and then it was really just an amazing time. But then they asked us, they said, the leader said to us, would you like to just find yourself a nice quiet spot, nice little spot there, and just lay on the floor? And they played music, and the presence of God just came into that place. It just filled that place. I had an appointment that I had to go to. I didn't want to leave. I wanted to stay there. I wanted to linger in the presence of God. Friend, can I say this? Get a hunger for the presence of God. You might be thinking right now, it's getting a little bit late. I got a hungering for a steak. I got a hungering for, I might get some Kentucky Fried Wings today. I don't know. But you might be thinking about that and all the juices on the inside of your belly is going like that. But I want to tell you, start getting a hunger for the things of God. Start getting a hunger for what God has in your life. Start going after God. Amen. Start speaking in other tongues. Start glorifying God. Start doing something, amen, that will stir inside you. I want to remind you that this little woman, she said, hey, come on. There would have been people who would have said, you're stupid, get away. There would have been people that would have been saying this and that, but I want to tell you, she did not listen. People might be talking about this church and they might be saying all kinds of things, that they do this and they do that. They sing in the spirit, they talk in tongues, they do that. Friend, I want to tell you, I'm going to talk in tongues till hell freezes over. Because everything I read about Jesus and the stories that they tell about Him, they said, hey, this Jesus who is coming, He is mightier than I. I might be baptizing you with water, but He's got something more powerful. He wants to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and with fire. Friend, that's how important it was. That's how important it was that God wanted to baptize you in the Holy Spirit, not so as that you could just be a tongue talker, but so as that you would be endued with power from on high. Acts 1:8 says, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. She said, if I can but touch the hem of His garment. And she pushed through. The Bible tells us the story. There were crowds thronging Him. But somehow or other, she touched the hem of His garment, and immediately virtue or power flowed out of Him into this woman. And immediately He knew. I want to tell you, friends, God knows when you touch Him. God knows when you touch Him, amen. The power flowed out of Him. He stopped and He said, who touched me? They said, you see the crowd thronging you, but this little woman fearing in her body, she said, I touched you. He said, daughter, your faith has made you whole. There's another man, he was sitting by the wayside blind. He could have stayed blind all his life. We can be blind to the things of the Spirit all of our lives. We can be blind to what God's doing. But I want to tell you, friends, if you start calling out Jesus, Jesus, Son of David, Jesus, there's got to come a cry. We want to have church nice. We don't want to upset anybody. We don't want this. We don't want that. But what does God want?
Amen. Jesus!
What does God want? What does God want? What does God want with our life? Here's this man, beggar's robe, blind all his life. But he started yelling out Jesus. He started yelling out that name. He started crying out that name. And that, something, how or other, there's something. There's something that's going to catch the attention of God Himself. There's something that will touch, and Jesus stopped. The people told him, be quiet. But he shouted the louder. And as he shouted the louder, Jesus stopped because it got his attention. And he said, tell him to come to me. Oh, friend, wouldn't it be great if God Almighty this morning could hear our praise, could hear our worship, could hear our love for him. And he would say, hey, bring him up here. I've got something for them. And he took off his beggar's robe and he said, what do you want? He said, that I might receive my sight. And immediately he was healed. Immediately he was healed. Friend, I want to say there's an hour that we're living in right now. It is an amazing hour. It is an hour of so much confusion. I was just wondering the other day, how many people are going to church in Guam right now. Now that there's a threat of disaster. Now there's a threat. I would imagine if we could only find out that the churches would be overflowing. People wanting to get right with God. People running to the altars, whatever it might be. But friend, you know, let's as a church, let's get a hunger on the inside of us. I've been amazed at our little Bible school that we're running. I call it the School of the Spirit. It's amazing. The presence of God just comes into that place. The anointing is just so amazing. It's like as if the seal of God is on it. As we pray, it's like the presence. It was from the very first day. It wasn't something that we built up. It was like God was waiting for us. I want to tell you, God is waiting for the church. He's waiting for us right now. He's looking for us right now that we'll come and get up beside him, put our arm around him and say, come on, Holy Spirit. Come on, Father. We want to see a move of your Spirit. Want to see the Sunshine Coast on fire for God. Amen. Want to see a move of God, amen. A move of God's Spirit. I can't get over that little woman. If I can but touch him. Break my heart, my God, for what breaks yours. Everything I have for your kingdom goes. Show me how to love like you love. Is that our prayer? Show me how to love like you love. Everything. Everything. He's either everything or he's nothing. Friends, he's either everything or he's nothing. It's not a... How many people need that touch to break something? Need something... I've had enough preaching. How many people want to respond somehow to God? Say, God, here I am for your kingdom cause. Let's stand to our feet. If you're in this house today, you might be going through it. You might be sitting on the side of the road begging. You might be discarded. That little woman was discarded by people. Because of what she had. Don't give up. Don't say it's over. Don't say it's hopeless. Believe God. Believe God. Friend, don't play with church. Don't play with the things of God. If you need to get born again, get born again. Give your life to Jesus. Get serious. Be serious. Whatever it is you need, just let the Spirit of God touch your life today. And I just want to open this altar this morning that somehow or other the Spirit of God might be able to untangle things and that we can just surrender, be His. I just want you to be able to be free. If you need to get born again, get born again. Get serious. Don't fluff around. If you don't get born again, you go to hell. That's the option. So let the Spirit of God wash over you. If you feel stagnant, dormant, whatever, let God touch you. But if that's you today and I want to be on this altar myself right now. I'm here because I want God to touch something in me that has to be touched. There's something inside of me that's got to get touched so I can become what God wants me to become too. You can come and stand with us today. Slip out of your seat and come. Holy Ghost.